Our next guest is not only an Aussie legend, but he's an all-round good guy who earlier this year farewelled the football field after an incredible career that spanned 20 years and four continents. Then earlier this year, he signed off the field for good after a stint with the Indian Super League and is now living in the UK studying the coaching side of the sport he absolutely loves. We are absolutely thrilled he is joining us here on Studio 10 this morning, the one and only Tim Cahill. Yay! Tim, welcome home.
Thank you.
Do you still call Australia home?
Of course. You know, when I come back, I get goosebumps, you know, landing last night quite late. And then it's just nice because this is where my family are, my parents, siblings, nephews and nieces. So it's beautiful to be back.
Wow. It's fantastic. And you've become an author like everyone else. So, like, what is with children's books? It's better than being the captain of the Socceroos, the most famous sporting star we've ever produced. I mean, there's got to be a lot of money in those babies, huh?
You know what? When you look at children's books, it started in 2015, November, planning life after football. I've just retired 6 months. And this is my 10th book. So I wanted to get to a level of recognition of my stories, telling, you know, my life, 16 years old, going across the other side of the world, but also the story of being told I'd never make it. Each headline gives you that, and the kids can align themselves with me and follow their dreams. But more importantly, now I'm in six countries around the world, but looking to take it globally now and really have a big push. Now it's one of my projects.
So with number 10, so number one, and how clever of you to start looking at life after. But tell me about number one, because this is number 10.
Yeah.
Number one, how did you do it?
Well, number one is, you always want to be that soccer superstar. So you're thinking about, you know, wanting to make it. And the reality of me making it is near enough impossible. 16 years old, mum's from Samoa, dad's from England, have to get a loan for me to go overseas.
Wow.
And then the hope and the dream. So throughout my books, you talk about the big break, you talk about all this stuff.
You're completely alone as well. You're 16-year-old or by yourself.
And I was totally fine with it because the sacrifices your parents make, and now living in 2019, I've got 16-year-old boy, 14-year-old boy, 12-year-old girl, 7-year-old boy, four of them, and they're in that situation now. You know, they want to be professional footballers. And
could you do that? Let your 14 or 16-year-old go?
Oh, look at them.
This is the reason why we moved back to England, because of the kids first, you know.
Because your parents clearly couldn't afford to go with you the first time round.
Yeah, and
until you sign the big contract.
Until you sign, it takes repetition of doing well. And this is the biggest motivation, you know, your parents and the sacrifices they make. And to be able to go through these stories and share them, the reality is a lot of kids are just looking for hope.
They are. Did you say all of your kids want to play professional football? And by that,
including
your daughter as well?
Book five or six, my daughter's in it. She's in this book too. Yeah. So it's me and Sienna holding hands and me walking her through the book.
Great.
So, you know, it's all about inclusion, the multiculturalism, understanding the world. Things are changing, dealing with issues. Just been in Lebanon now with the FIFA legends.
Yeah.
With the president Infantino and a lot of big stars, Kaká, Mourinho, Samuel Eto'o, and we've just launched the FIFA for Schools program. So we travel all around the world, hopefully give out 11 million footballs in that time and spend a lot of money on kids.
Let's take a look. And it's beautiful you're writing these books. It's beautiful you're giving back. You're doing coaching now or studying coaching. But you, for anyone who doesn't know, and I can't imagine anyone doesn't, but the things that you have done in your career are just, it's fairy tale stuff. There was one here we're going to see. This is the 2006 World Cup. I was out there watching the whole thing in Norton Street.
By Tim Cahill!
This is you scoring the first goal in the World Cup, I believe it was, for the Socceroos. I mean, how does that feel in a sport where goals are as rare as hen's teeth and you can do more in 10 minutes than most players can do in a whole game? What does that feel like for you? Is it just surreal?
Honestly, looking back at it now, you don't get to watch it as often. I think for me, to retire and have these moments and now to be able to share it, that's what you play for. Mm. You know, I only ever wanted to be a professional footballer, and the only time I make a difference is on the pitch.
Yeah.
One of the biggest things is off the pitch now. You know, I left school at 16. I promised myself when I finished my career, 39, you know, did a business course at Harvard now.
Wow.
I'm studying and trying to, you know, just be an example to my kids and kids to try and, you know, be positive and have a crack at anything.
And that was obviously that was your second favourite moment in sport. I think this is your ultimate career highlight. Yeah, there you go.
Yeah, this is good. This is good.
Do you find it intimidating to be up against an athlete of that stature?
This was probably one of my most nervous moments. Like, I was a little bit intimidated because you did really show me up there.
Yeah. And so don't get up there. A lot of it's in the mind.
Yeah.
So you just got to...
Thank you.
Just quickly, so many, some, sadly, sports people come undone in that important transition from the active part of their career to what happens afterwards. How important is all that planning you've put into what comes after? And is that part of the example you're setting for young sports people, do you think?
Yeah, I think for me is you live in a business world that's controlled by commercial. Mm. You have to educate yourself very early. Being in the Premier League in England for 15 years and moving to New York and playing in that environment and then to China and all these places is I set up a team of just Jake and Chris Elder, who are close to me, and we pretty much function off just enjoying ourselves but also protecting what you've earned.
Yeah, sure.
And for me, education is everything, and being realistic and holistic approach that football's not everything. It is, it's what's made me, but it's how you control that afterwards to build that platform. And I like to be involved. I like to be hands-on, and it's a bit of everything that I've learned. And it's difficult for players that transition afterwards if they've never been involved or understand what's actually happening. Correct. So
not only smart, author, looking after kids, giving back, you're also an ambassador for greyhound adoption. Where did that come from?
Well, this is different. You know, I'm nearly turning 40 and this is a responsibility and also accountability. You know, I really put myself out there to someone that was open to questions of adversity. I don't mind that. But from when I signed with the greyhounds, from that day forward, it was all the good that I was going to do. Mm. It's not what's happened before me. And it's the implementation of... when you get a greyhound, then you should be accountable to rehome it. You know, it should be inside the contract.
And you've adopted one. But, I mean, we see so many badly behaved young men in Australian football or league. All of a sudden they get to an age, they're earning a lot of money and they completely go off the rails. So what's the difference?
I think we've all had situations individually that you have to learn from. Mm-hmm. The question is if you learn from it and if you take that on and if you choose the right direction you want to see. And how much is a lot of money, really? After tax and what you earn in Australia, you really have to look at it for longevity because you can only have a contract for 8 years or 5 years. Yeah. You've got a mortgage, you've got your parents to look after.
Yeah, but obviously you've had a great background and you were devoted to your parents who've sacrificed so much.
Yeah, my motivation is my kids. You know, how am I going to pay their school fees for the rest of their life and then their university fees? That's what I thought of as a player. And how can you keep that in your mind when you've got four children? So you have to turn responsible. And for me, it's more... I don't mind the mistakes. I don't mind. It's how do you learn from it and how do people help them? Strong, you know, that's the key. Yeah.
Well, my son's playing the Marrickville Red Devils under seven, so
that's
they're, looking,
I was.
For a, they're looking for a coach to do just part-time. No so problems. If you're free next year,
Tim, you're a great sports person, a great Australian, but most importantly, you are a fantastic role model.
Thank you so much for joining us this morning
on Studio 10. Big round of applause. Latest edition of the Tiny Tim series, The New Coach, is available in bookstores now. Thank you once again, Tim. Now, after the break...
Thank you.